Hello everyone. We gather together to do Chanukat Bayit today. So the most important thing is to start with explaining what Chanukat Bayit is. And then we will speak a little bit about the parasha that we read yesterday. And then I will go over some of the things the Rambam says about moving into a house. And then in the end, when we finish my speech, each one of us will take a chapter of the tikkun. There's a special tikkun for Chanukat Bayit. Each one reads five to ten minutes. And like this we cover everything that this special tikkun has. And Be'ezrat Hashem there will be bracha in this house. What's the whole idea of Chanukat Bayit? So obviously we're starting to learn that when Bnei Israel built the Mishkan, the temporary Beit HaMikdash, before they entered the Holy Land, as they were moving in a desert for 40 years, but in the beginning, Rosh Chodesh Nisan, they already make the Chanukat Bayit. They opened the Mikdash, and the first Beit HaMikdash, also the same thing, when they move into Eretz Israel, Shlomo HaMelech also made a special party to open the Beit HaMikdash, which was the first, they just built it. So we see that every time, according to the Judaism, every time you start something, you build something new, or you start something new, you make something that called Chanukat Bayit. So obviously, it's very, very crucial when you build a house. When you build a house and nobody ever lived there, that's the most important thing. Why, after all, we do it when we move into a house that could be there 40, 50 years? Why we do it? For different reasons. It's not a new house. Many people lived there before. Just because people lived there before, we don't know who these people are and what they used to do. And according to the Torah, the things that people do makes an impact on everything around them in a creation. Which means if a person makes a sin in his home, every inch of his house contaminates spiritually from his sins. Every inch of the house, the floor, the rug, the couch, the walls, everything. You understand? And because, for instance, sometimes you move into an apartment, you don't know who lived there before. It could be there were Korean people, Chinese people, Japanese people, all kinds of this kind of Eastern people, the Oriental people, most of them, not all of them, but most of them follow idols. They're worshipping idols. And they have all kinds of customs that are completely, completely against the Torah. And because they bring the idols into their home, right? And they even worship their idols in their home, or they have pictures of their idols in the home. So that's a very serious problem. We have to purify the home from all this Avodah Zarah. How do we know if there was Avodah Zarah in the house? We have to purify the place. We found that Hashem told the nation of Israel when they entered the land, there were seven empires sitting there. Seven major countries that all sit in the Holy Land. Eretz Knaan, Aknaani, Achiti, Amori, Aprizi, Evusi, Girgashi. All these nations, Shiva Amim, they're all worshipping idols of the Avodah Zarah. And what does the Torah say? To burn everything they left there, not to leave one souvenir. Not only to destroy it from the ground. You have to dig under the roots of it, not to leave even one inch from what they had over there. And not to have mercy on them, because if there's one thing God hates, is people who worship idols. That explains in our time why in places like Haiti, in India, in Thailand, the tsunamis, the biggest tragedies in our time happen in places when people worship idols. Voodoo, black magic, they are the experts in Haiti over there. And also, if you know, 500,000 people died in a tsunami, most of them were idols worshippers. And also problem with modesty, which is another problem, but usually this is the way it works. Now, so the Torah say when you move into a house, this tikkun is able to take all the bad energy from the house, and this is one other reason why we do it. Now, what about Christians? If Christians live in a house before you bought it, also Avodah Zarah. If a Muslim lives there, it's not Avodah Zarah. He prayed to the same God. He believes in Muhammad, which according, you know, we know that Muhammad wasn't a prophet. He never gave even one prophecy. The Quran has no prophecies, not even one. It's a fake religion. It's religion but made by people. It's full of human errors, full of mistakes. If you watch my movie, you know what I'm talking about. So Quran is definitely not a divine religion. However, that doesn't mean Muslims are worshipping an idol. They are against idols. And they scream to one God. And they believe in the same God. And they also believe in all the Jewish legendary righteous people. Abraham, Yitzchak, Yaakov, David, all these, Yosef, all these names are holy for them. Okay, therefore, if you bought a house from a Muslim, the Muslim didn't make so much bad energy in the house. If he made different sins, fine. But because of his religion, there's not so much bad energy in the house. What happens if the Christian is in the house? Christians are worshipping an idol. JC, it's an idol. They made God a son. God never had a son. And they put the tree, and they put all kinds of statues with the images of Maria and all these things, which is 100% Avodah Zarah. Buying a house from them, it's not a good start. That's why we need Chanukah Tabayit. We found people that sometimes move into a house, they lived there for many years and didn't have success in anything they do. And right after they did Chanukah Tabayit, within a month, everything started to change in their life. Since we do not know, for instance, we look at this apartment probably is what, 70, 80 years old? At least. It could be 20 people lived there. It could be bad impression from someone who lived there 60 years ago. Someone that had an idol here 60 years ago, already Chas v'Shalom can bring a bad energy into the house. And that's why we have to do this Chanukah Tabayit. One other reason, when I started to mention before, is the most dangerous thing is to move into a house that you build, that nobody lived there before. It doesn't make sense. If bad people live there, then they make bad impression. If nobody lived there, all brand new, why we have to worry? Because when you build a house, nobody comes there. There's no mezuzot. You build the frame. The house is not finished for a period of 6 months, 12 months, until you build the house. The workers work there during the day. They don't even have electric. They just build the frames. They put the walls. They put the windows. And nobody lives there. The Gemara said that the place that nobody lives, the demons like to go there. That's the place that they like to live in. They either go to the forest when people don't go there, there's no lights there, or into churva. Churva means either a house that collapsed, even partially, or nobody lives there anymore. They block they put boards and they block the windows, and then for years nobody lives there. So the demons, there are six different kinds of demons. Three demons are like people, that they eat, they drink, they go to the bathroom, they have exits. And three kinds of demons that are like the angel. They're spiritual, they don't eat, they don't go to the bathroom, none of this. Those demons are hiding in places when people never lived there before. It's called churva, or a place that it's what we call new construction. The Gemara said that one of the Chachamim, it's in Masechet Brachot, he was looking for a place to pray. And he was looking for a place to pray, and he didn't want to stand in the middle of the street and everybody looking at him. So he found a churva, a place that it's neglected. And he went inside and he prayed. And Eliyahu Navi was waiting for him to finish his prayer, and then he told him that you just risk your life going into a place like this, because you should know that places like this are dangerous, and a person shouldn't go alone. You should always go with another person, or with light, with a torch, or something like this. It's very interesting, because about maybe 10 years ago, we had a girl in Muncie. We used to have a forest in front of our house, and we used the forest as a shortcut. And we walked through the trees to go from the other side of the street. It's saving us a huge circle. We cut through the forest. And as I told you, the forest is one of the places they like to go. So this girl, one time when she went in the evening, it started to become dark, she went through the forest, she felt that somebody hit her on her back. It's like you take your two hands and you hit a woman on her back and you make her fall on the floor, and then she looked around and she heard all kinds of voices and she couldn't see anything. She came home half fainted. She was shaking for a week from what happened. She said, I only heard voices, but I didn't see anything. I don't know how to explain. They even sent her to check that she's mentally fine. She was a smart woman, everything was fine. And obviously, this is one of the things that I was talking about. Now, You know, I want to speak a little bit about the, this is explaining about the parasha, the Chanukat Habayit. And Chanukah comes from the word Chanicha. Chanicha means something new, to start something new, Lachnoch. So, yesterday we had Parshat Vaera, and the week before we started Sefer Shmot. This is, we started Sefer Shmot, this is the second week of Sefer Shmot. We start from the previous parasha, 8 days ago. We saw that Paro told the Mialdot, Shifra and Pua, that when the babies are born, to kill them. And the Mialdot, they told Paro, Paro told them, why you didn't listen to me? You're risking your life, I'm the king. You had to listen to me. So they said, the Jewish women are not like the Goyot. Before you even get to them, they're already giving birth. So what's this whole conversation is about? Paro should have told him, I can care less. Like the Goyot, not the Goyot. I told you to kill the babies. What do I care if they gave birth or not? So what is this argument? This argument is an argument that we already have for thousands of years. It didn't start today. It's already then. If abortion is murder or not, that's where the argument starts here. Paro say to them, before they give birth, before the baby comes out, kill him inside the womb. Don't let him come out. Even if he takes one part of his body out, as long as he didn't come out, for me, you kill them inside, it's legal, no problem. So they told him, when we got there, it was too late, the baby was out already. The head was out, the head is out, that's it. It's considered and he's born. So obviously you can see, if Paro wanted to kill the baby, what's the problem? You kill him, we take him as he is and kill him. You know, but the problem is, he told them, no. You know, you have to kill them, the babies, before they are born. Like this, we don't have conscious problems, nobody makes demonstrations, all the liberal Egyptians, they're not going to come and stand by my palace and say, hey, what's going on, you kill innocent babies. Because remember, in history there's always minorities that they demonstrate and they have problems. And you know, the people of Egypt, they were very opinionated people. How do we know? Because in the beginning they came to Paro and they told him, they demanded that he's going to make the Jews slaves. He didn't want in the beginning. So they fired him from his job. They pushed him out of his home, out of his palace, and they told him, we don't want you as a king. And then after a short period of time, he realized that he lost his position. He came back and he said, okay, we'll do it. Well, we'll do it in a very clever way. If we tell all of them, now you have to be slaves, they can make a war here. There's going to be riots on the street. So let's first give them a salary. We'll tell them that you get paid, and myself and you will come and also work for money. Later, the Egyptians will quit, and they'll stay, and then later we'll stop paying them. By then, they already will be in it, they're not going to have a choice. And this is how they did it. The question is, why Shifra and Pua didn't tell Paro, okay, if that's the case, you want us to make an abortion? We are not interested. We get fired. We quit. We retire. That's it. We don't wanna deliver babies. You cannot force me to work, right? So far, remember, it's still not slavery yet. You want me to kill the babies inside? I don't want to work. I don't want to go and deliver babies. Get somebody else to do it. They didn't say that. Not only they didn't say it, they actually went to do the job to save the babies. They knew if they'll quit, somebody else may not be strong like them. They're going to go, they will be afraid from the king, they'll kill the babies. Right? The couples in Germany, the Jewish couples, they did horrible things to the Jews to save their own body. They figure, if I'll be cruel to these Jews, the Nazis will leave me alone. They'll see that I'm one of them. If I'll be nice to them, they'll kill me. What's the point? He didn't care about them. He only cared about himself. So over there, they went and they risked their life to save the baby. So the Torah said that Hashem was very satisfied from them, was very happy from them, and he made them homes. What homes? Batei Keuna uvatei Leviya. He made, Rashi writes, that the Kohanim and the Leviim of the nation of Israel will come from them. Now, we know that all the reward and the punishments in the Torah are all measure for measure. Everything you do, that's what you did. Which means, you lost $100, That means you stole $50 from someone. Why? So why you lose 100? Because the Torah says a thief has to pay double. Hashem takes away from you. It doesn't have to be tomorrow. It can be 20 years later. The computer of Hashem never missed anything. It just decides his own timing when he wants to punish you. A person deserves to die. It's Mechalel Shabbat. According to the Torah, he has no right to live. But Hashem is keeping him 7 years. When the time comes, that's what happened in Israel a week ago. A soccer player playing on Shabbat, riding on his motorcycle, not even 50 years old, something like that. A truck came, the mirror of the truck hit him in his head. He had a helmet, but it was half helmet, not full helmet. Something happened to his head. 3-4 days he was in coma and he died. Everyone in Israel is in shock. Why is it? This is a person that was bringing thousands of people to see him playing on Shabbat. They all come with cars. They do violation of the rules of Shabbat. Hashem doesn't bring his punishment right away. He has a lot of patience. Sometimes the punishment is only after the death, not in this world, Bechlal. The same thing, the reward. The reward and the punishment are not instant. If the reward and the punishment will be instant, there will not be any free choice. There's no test. Life has no meaning. If God will immediately punish us for every little thing we do, of course we're not going to make sins. Who wants to get punished a minute later? Or if He will reward us right away for everything good we do, everyone will do constantly only mitzvot. Nobody will go to work. Everybody will sit and learn Torah, seeing the reward immediately. For every word of Torah, how much you earn, of course you won't go to work. The world will not be able to be anything. No work, no business, no doctors, no nothing. Everybody would sit and learn Torah non-stop because they see the actual profit. Like this, it's all confused. And those who have strong faith in the Torah that every word is the word of God, they know I have to have patience. If God promised me in the Torah that the reward for someone who learns Torah is the highest of all highest, then I have nothing to worry about. The time will come and I'll cash on my reward. This is how it goes. So now, why Hashem gave them Kehuna and Leviya? What's the connection by saving the babies? You should have said, okay, since you save babies, I'll give you many babies. You have many children, many grandchildren. Your children will be great. If your children, somebody would want to kill them, then I will bring somebody to save your own children because you saved my children. So I'm going to save your children. This is called Midah Keneged Midah. What's the connection between saving lives of babies to becoming Kohen and Levi? What's the connection? What was the plan of Paro? It's much deeper than when you read the parasha. If you don't know the oral Torah, you don't understand 1% of the Torah. Nothing. All the Torah that we know today is come from the Gemara, from the Mishnah, from the Zohar. This is the oral part of the Torah. The written Torah is only 1%. The rest, everything we know, comes from the oral Torah, Torah Shebe'al Peh. So the Torah Shebe'al Peh explains what was the plan of Paro. You know, if I'll kill all the male, all the Jewish male, and I'm going to keep all the female, the female will continue to give me babies. That means I'm going to have free slaves. Everyone is a free slave. We'll make them work, they make roads, they build buildings, they clean our houses. Very nice to have a nation of slaves. They all work for you for free. However, what's the point? Why not to keep the male also? No, you have double people. Not only female. Now you have a lot of men. The men will do the hard job, no? The idea is that Pharaoh knew, remember, when the nation of Israel went to Egypt, there were 70 people only. Yaakov went to Egypt with all his sons, their wives, their grandchildren, everything together, 70, include Yosef and his two sons. 70 Jews, that's it. They went to Egypt because there was no food all over the world. It was all hunger. When Yaakov went to Egypt, don't ever forget that Yaakov already learned Torah 14 years in the yeshiva of Shem Va'ever. Yitzchak was a holy man. Avraham Avinu, the Torah says, I love Avraham because he kept my Torahs and all my mitzvot. So you see, Avraham Avinu, before the Torah was even given, was a perfect tzaddik. Adam, he knew what the Torah is. Noach, he knew the Torah. His son Shem, he was a Rosh Yeshiva, he had a yeshiva. What Torah they taught? There was no Torah yet. The Torah only was given when the nation of Israel came out of Egypt 49 days after. 210 years they were in Egypt. Officially, there was no Torah in the world. So the answer is, of course, there was Torah. When we say Matan Torah, when the Jews received Torah in Har Sinai 3,320 years ago in Chag Shavuot, 49 days after the Exodus of Egypt, we mean that the Torah was published to the whole world. It doesn't mean the Torah wasn't given already to the Jews. First, the mitzvah of Shabbat was given to the Jews before the Torah. The Jews already kept Shabbat when they came to Mount Sinai. They were Shomrei Shabbat, all of them. Avraham Avinu kept all the Torah, everything. How did he know what Torah to keep if there was no Torah? It's inside the Torah that Hashem said, Avraham kept all my Torah, all my mitzvot. When Noah came after the flood from the ark, he took kosher animals, pure animals, and sacrificed them to Hashem. How did he know to tell the difference between kosher animals to non-kosher animals if there's no Torah? The only way to know it is with the Torah. Right? Adam wrote Mizmor Shir Leyom HaShabbat. We have in Tehillim a Mizmor. Mizmor Shir Leyom HaShabbat. Tov Leodot LaHashem. Who wrote it? Adam HaRishon. So Adam HaRishon wrote a Mizmor already. Adam HaRishon named all the animals. Adam HaRishon had Ruach HaKodesh. You see that the animals have very, very interesting name. Kelev Kulo Lev. Is very faithful to his owner. Sus, Sas Lakrav. He is going to fight. That's why his name is Sus. Nachash, why Nachash? It's two words. Nach, Chash. First he's resting, he frees, and then he attack. Chash means hairy. First Nach, Nach means rest. Second word, hairy. 1 second before he attack, he pause, and boom! You realize it's over already. That's why his name is Nachash. All the animals, all their names are all holy. How Adam knew all these names? It was just created, of course. It was created with Ruach HaKodesh. The angels, when they saw Adam, they thought this is God. That's how much it confused them. Because it was shining like a sun. His ankle alone, he was big, giant, before the sin. His ankle alone was like the sun, bright like a sun. We don't have understanding. His whole body was nail. There was no flesh. All body was nailed. After the sin, Hashem left a souvenir. Here a little bit and in the feet a little bit. To show us how we were supposed to be without the sin. If a person is covered with nail, he never dies. The worms will never eat the body, like in a grave. This is the end of a person. A person would live forever. Nail can stay a billion years. No problem. If your body was covered with nail, you take a nail, you leave it, you come a billion years later, it's right, it's there. Nothing can affect nails. Not the climate, cold weather, hot weather, humidity, all kinds of things in the air. The nails are staying the same. Everything else automatically died after a certain period of time. But nail, it's a special thing. And that's why the impurity stays in the nails. That's why we have to wash our hands, we get up in the morning. Why the hands? Why not the whole hand? Only here where the nails are. Originally we were supposed to do netila also on the legs. But the impurity in the legs is so strong that the netila cannot take away the impurity. That's why we're not, according to the Torah, you don't touch your legs. If you touch your legs right away, you have to wash your hands. Everything connected. Most Jews, as I always say, they are so ignorant, they don't have even 1/1,000,000,000% knowledge from the Torah. Not even 1/1,000,000,000% from the Torah. They have a lot of speeches against the Torah. They have a lot of opinions against the Torah. But they make a lot of noise. In reality, they don't know anything. Most Jews today in the world, they cannot even tell you who is the wife of Avraham Avinu, who is the wife of Noah. Go to the Israeli kibbutz, take 1,000 kids from school. Tell them who was Noah, not one of them would know. I'll give you an example. One Rebbe, he speaks in a yeshiva in Israel, 10 minutes every Friday. Now you know, a rabbi with a beard and a black yarmulke, the chance that the elementary secular school will allow him to come and speak words of Torah in a secular school is below zero. Because they hate the Torah so much, all these people, they want to live their phony life and they don't want anybody to come show us how wrong we are. That's why they never allow. They will allow the priest in, they allow the Muslim, they allow anyone, but they will never allow a rabbi to come and speak to these kids words of Torah. So this rabbi is giving words of Torah inside the yeshiva, inside the school. So his rabbi asked him, how did you do it? How did you get to speak words of Torah inside an elementary secular school? So he told him, I'll tell you what happened. Erev Shavuot, evening of Shavuot, I call up the principal and I told her, I want to come speak in your school for 10 minutes only. And all I want to do is to teach the kids what Chag Shavuot is. Would you allow me? She said, come to my office, we'll talk. He went to the office, principal is a woman. She said to him, listen, you know, the parents will get very upset if they hear that the rabbi spoke here, they're anti, they don't want. But I have to present it in a way that it wasn't really Torah. You know, you speak about the holiday, it's not, no problem. But I want you to write, to protect myself, I want you to sign for me that you're only going to speak about Chag Shavuot and nothing else. You're not going to mention anything about the Torah. So he signed, no problem, 10 minutes, fine. He tells them about Chag Shavuot, why do we eat dairy, what happened when Moshe Rabbeinu brought the Torah, they just found all the meat was not kosher because they didn't know the law of slaughtering, and they found out there's nothing to eat, so they ran to the cows, they milked them, they prepared some dairy food, it was an hour or two, that's it. There's no time to slaughter now new cows, put salt to get rid of all the blood, oh, it takes a whole day, there's no time. That's why for 3,320 years we eat dairy. And the kids are very impressed and never knew anything about it. And once he finished, he had 1 minute left. So he said, children, I want to ask you, do you know when David HaMelech was born? Of course they don't know. So he said, he told them, Chag Shavuot. Do you know where he died? They don't know. Also Chag Shavuot. Now we have 20 seconds left. So he said to them, I have one last question before I go. Do you know who wrote the book of Tehillim? 400 kids sitting there in an auditorium there. Nobody knows. In Tel Aviv, nobody knows. 400 kids, they didn't know who wrote Sefer Tehillim. So he said, I'll give you a hint. David, everybody scream, Ben Gurion! I don't have to tell you where the principal, where to hide. On the way out, she told him, I'm so embarrassed. Wow, Hashem, wow, I can't believe it. They didn't know who wrote Sefer Tehillim, like she knew. But anyway, she said to him, you know what? I agree with you. 10 minutes of Judaism, it's urgent. And that's how he got the job. They allow him 10 minutes a week. It's just to show you that most Jews have no idea what they live for, Bichlal. They don't know the Torah is from Hashem, it's divine. They don't know there's heaven and hell. They don't know 7 different places in hell. They don't know for every little sin you do, you must pay. You cannot avoid it. Here you can fool the judge, you can fool the FBI, you can fool, you bribe the witnesses, you can do whatever you want over here. Over there you cannot avoid anything. If you die guilty, oy vey, oy vey. You want to die righteous, you don't want to die wicked. And most of the people, they live the way they live for 2 reasons. One, ignorance. They don't understand what they live for. They don't know. They never learned the Torah. Torah means instructions. Torah. It's a divine book. And the second reason why they like this, because they don't see an immediate punishment. So they lose their faith. They hear the rabbi say that you're not allowed to be mechalel Shabbat. But they see that the 70-80% of the Jews in the world driving on Shabbat and nothing happens to them. Once in a while you hear an accident here, an accident, but most of them, they go on a picnic, on a boat, everyone celebrate, they eat not kosher in their weddings, everything is fine. Where is the justice? If they only read the Torah once in their life, they knew that you're not supposed to expect justice immediately, because they will eliminate the free choice. The opposite. The Torah says clearly, without any doubt, those who I love, I postpone the reward. Those who I hate, I pay them cash to get rid of them. For what I pay them cash? It's the last 3 verses on Parashat Vayetchanan. You don't have to believe me. Open the Torah, Parashat Vayetchanan. Read the last 3 verses. I am the strict God who pay my lovers, who keep my mitzvot for thousands of generations. And pay my haters, those who don't keep my mitzvot, immediately to their face, to get rid of them. I will not delay their payment even a bit. I paid them to their face, and I owe them nothing. This is verses in the Torah. No rabbis, this, the prophet. Clearly in the Torah. Most of the secular Jews in the world, they believe in a written Torah. They have all kinds of arguments about the oral Torah, the Gemara, the Chachamim, fine. everything can be proven that it's all divine, but that's not the time right now. But the written Torah, or at least the Ten Commandments, almost every person in the world believes in. And over there, it's enough to ask them, so why do you live in a lie? Why? You claim in one hand that you believe in it, on the other hand you do everything the opposite. So the answer is, because they have hopes that they are good people. That's why I see everywhere I go. Yeah, I'm not a religious rabbi, but I'm a very good person. I don't steal, I don't do this, I don't do this. First of all, everything that they say, it's not true. Because most of the people, they hold themselves honest because they don't steal. I prove to you that everyone who says I don't steal, he steals every day. To steal doesn't mean to rob a bank or to go to your friend's pocket and steal his wallet. That's already an exaggeration. To steal means to steal a stamp from your boss at work, to use the phone without permission, to take envelopes from the office to go home and use it for your private use, to go into a store and take napkins, not buying anything there. You go there, you take 20 napkins, and you go out and clean your hands. You know, this is all stealing. To steal could be many, many things. To pick up a flower from someone's garden, to make a shortcut into someone's property without permission. So many things. Your friend give you a car to drive from here to Great Neck. And on the way, you pass through, I don't know, somewhere else, another 10 miles. What's the difference? I'm already having the car. Okay, let me go over there. That's stealing. It's another $5 gas, or $3, whatever it is. Din pruta ke din mea. If you're a thief, you're a thief. It doesn't matter how much you stole. Of course, the more you steal, the more you're going to have to pay. But the idea of being a thief or not, being honest or not, it could be in $1. So this is just to give us an understanding. Okay, let's move on. So the point is that Paro wanted them to kill the babies. Why? Because he wants the women to stay. One generation, we are going to kill all the male. There will not be ever where they're going to have to marry the goyim. If they marry the goyim, there will never be kohanim and leviim. How Paro know that they're supposed to be kohanim and leviim? How Paro knew? Paro knew because we already, as I told you, Abraham transferred to Yitzchak. Yitzchak transferred to Yaakov. Yaakov transferred to all his children. The children that came to Mitzrayim, Shevet Levi, were learning in Eretz Goshen Torah. They were not slaves. All the tribes were slaves. Shevet Levi sitting over there. And as the law in Egypt, that Kohanei Dat, people that are religious, they don't call them to work. They can sit and learn their religion. Believe it or not, in Egypt, Shevet Levi do not work. That's why Shevet Levi was the smallest tribe. Why? Because those who work very hard, Hashem made a miracle that they will multiply fast. They'll have many children. But since Shevet Levi did not suffer, they were the smallest Shevet. They didn't have so much miracles on their birth. Because the Torah says, "Ka'asher ye'anu oto, ken yirbe ve'ken yifrotz." The more the Egyptians torture them, the more babies they have. How can it be? You work, you're a slave, you have time to give birth and to raise children? That's the whole miracle. Now I'm going to tell you a very interesting secret here. The reason Hashem gave Shifra and Pua that the Kohanim and the Leviim and the kings came from them, because they knew that if one generation they'll kill the male Jews and they will have to marry the Egyptians, the Goyim, a Goy that marry a Jewish woman, the kids are Jewish. But they can never be Kohen, and can never be Levi ever again. You kill the entire generation. And Paro knew, if I'm going to avoid the Kohanim and the Leviim, they will stay here forever as slaves. Because I know the plans. Yaakov already told them, one day you build the Beit HaMikdash, you go to the Holy Land. How do I prevent it? By eliminating Kohanim and Leviim. That's why they saved the babies. And thanks to that, they had Kohanim and Leviim. And Hashem said, you know what? If there's Kohanim and Leviim, who's going to be your children? Measure for measure. That's how it works. Now my question to you is, why God punished the entire nation of Egypt? The problem was between him and Paro. Paro doesn't want to release the nation of Israel, no? Why you kill now every firstborn in the entire land of Egypt? Blood, frogs, so much problems in Egypt. Take care of Paro and finish him. Why you make so many innocent people supposedly suffer? So the answer is, when a nation has a wicked king, all they have to do, like in Iran today, if in Iran all the good people were gathered together and they decided in 1 hour to get rid of this fanatic, idiotic regime, it would take 1 hour. They'll burn the entire Iran and that would be the end of it. They will lose control, that's it. They burn cars, they burn places, they burn buses, they burn malls, they shoot with guns all over, they'll say, okay, we surrender. Right away, United States come in, Israel, everything, and no more Islam. It can happen in an hour. The problem is that there was only 10,000 Braves one. If it would be 10 million Braves one, many of them hate them. They're afraid, but if they would be united, they would knock them out. Same thing here. If the, in the end of all these problems, the nation of Egypt forced Paro to send the Jews out of Mitzrayim. Why didn't you do it 210 years? 210 years he's torturing a whole nation. You don't care. Now, when you begin to suffer, you see, when you want, you got rid of him. The question is, why didn't you get rid of him first, before? Only when I started to punch you, you begin to do it. That's why they all suffer. Paro himself didn't die. When the nation of Paro ran after the Jews, the army, all of them drowned except one. Who? Paro. Why Paro didn't die? Where is the justice? Imagine, the entire Iraqi army was destroyed and Saddam didn't die. They let him go. What justice is this? The first one you have to go after is the head of all the wicked arms. The answer is, because the Torah says clearly that Hashem took away his free choice. Hashem told Moshe, I'm not going to let Paro, from a certain point on, he won't choose anymore what to do. His heart and his head will be in my hand. I will put words in his mouth. I will not let him send the Jews. Why? I want to take revenge against them after 210 years. What's the point? You say, okay, Moshe, let them go. Finished. He makes tshuva. You cannot touch him. So what's the answer? The answer is that Hashem kept him alive to see what happened to his nation. And plus, since he took away his free choice, he's the one who survived and he didn't drown. The frogs in Mitzrayim, there were millions of millions or supposedly billions of frogs all over Egypt. Try to imagine your life. You get up in the morning, you get up, your bed is full of frogs in your clothes, in your face, jumping under the blanket. You go to the bathroom, it's full of frogs. All the floor, you cannot walk. Everywhere, the Torah said that Egypt was full of frogs. They didn't know what to do. The frogs, every door you open, right away, a flood of frogs coming in. You open the oven to make challah, millions of them inside. Think about it, what's happened over there? This is the Torah described. Bemisharotecha, in every inch of your property, you won't find one little dot that is empty. Even inside the ovens, they jump. The Torah brings 2,600 years ago a story of three righteous Jews, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. What's special about Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah? Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, they jumped into the fire. Nebuchadnezzar wanted to destroy them. There was a big statue. They said, okay, we're not going to bow down to this statue. We're going to jump into the fire. The Gemara says, how did they know they have to jump into the fire? They learned from the frogs. The frogs jumped into the fire of the ovens of the Egyptians. They sent the frogs to do what God told them. They were willing to jump into the fire. If the frogs that doesn't have a free choice, doesn't get a reward and a punishment, were willing to sacrifice their life just to do the word of God, we, as Jews, are the chosen people. We represent God in the world, and he told us that we have to sanctify his name, Kiddush Hashem, for sure we'll jump into the fire. What do we worry about? We have life after life. Shouldn't worry. So the question is, why the frogs didn't make Kiddush Hashem? Who told the frogs? The frogs didn't have a choice if God is moving them. If God said the frogs will go into the ovens, what free choice they have? They had to go into the ovens. All the animals, they move based on God's decision. They live with instinct. If God wants the animals to come after us, you're going to see a million animals running over. Who moves them? They don't know what to do. He moves them around. You know, today I heard in Arkansas 1,000 birds fell burn on the floor. Did you hear that? 1,000 birds. Nobody understand. Oh, 1,000 birds fell all over. Dead birds. They don't know. They check them. They don't know what killed them. Hashem wanted a flood of dead birds to fall on them. That's what he does. What? Hashem wants a plane to crash. He sent a bird in such huge sky. Well, right into the engine of that plane. It's not coincidence. He used the animals as his messengers. So the answer is, and we almost finished, the answer is, nobody told to the frogs which one of them has to go to the fire. Hashem said to Pharaoh, by Moshe, the frogs will fill up your entire properties, even the ovens. But none of the frogs was forced to go into the oven. They jump everywhere. The frogs who were jumping into the fire, they did it out of his own instinct. This is what God wants us to do. They jumped in. So which frog survived? After all the frogs died, they make piles. You know how we make piles with the snow all over now? There were piles of frogs all over, and it was horrible smell. Vayiv Ash, the Torah said the smell over there was horrible. Imagine like millions of dead rats in the street. What a tragedy. Which frogs did not die? Those who went into the oven, they survived. All the other ones died. Those who jumped into the fire, Chazal said, they didn't die. It's very interesting. You know, I'll tell you, before we finish this and then we read the tikkun, I'll tell you a good joke, you know, to wake you up a little bit. And then I'll tell you a very interesting story that you'll never forget in your whole life. One rabbi went to give a lecture. They set up his place, they put the microphone, everything. He sits on the stage and he doesn't start talking. 10 minutes, 20 minutes. So the gabbai comes to him, "Rabbi, everything okay? Why you don't start saying anything?" So the rabbi says, "I forgot my teeth at home in the glass." So he said, "Well, give him the address." So he sent quickly somebody. He went there, he got the glass with the teeth. He brings him the glass. He takes the teeth, he puts it in, he begins to talk. 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, everyone is falling asleep already. So the rabbi says, "Rabbi, we have to close the shul. It's already 1 o'clock. Do you have plans to continue all night?" The rabbi says, "I can't stop. What do you want me to do? You brought me my wife's teeth." So even if I want to stop, I can. It's automatically moving, you know. So you know, it's we do Chanukat HaBayit. One of the things you do in Chanukat HaBayit when you move in, usually people do Chanukat HaBayit the week that they move in, so they put mezuzot. It's a part of the Chanukat HaBayit. So one guy, he lived in a house for 1 year, and 3 times they broke into the house. 3 times. So I went to the rabbi. I said, "Rabbi, I have a problem. Robbers rob me 3 times a year." So the rabbi said, "You have a mezuzah, kosher mezuzah in the door?" He said, "I don't have mezuzah at all, rabbi." "Rabbi, you don't have mezuzah and you're wondering why they rob your house? You have no protection. Torah said the mezuzah, it's good kosher mezuzah, it's protection from sicknesses, from problems. You need mezuzah." Right away he comes, he gives him mezuzah. He says, "Put the mezuzah," and you see how everything turned around. He put the mezuzah as the rabbi told him. A month later, the rabbi passed by, knock on the door. "No? You are protected now?" He says, "Rabbi, take the mezuzah back." He comes, he brings the mezuzah from the drawer, he gives it to him. "So what's the problem?" He says, "Rabbi, I prefer to have 3 robberies in my house a year than 30 collectors coming every month to my door." Once he put the mezuzah, all the collectors, they go, you know, they come to Great Neck. How do you know which house is the Jew now? They go by the mezuzah. Every house they see mezuzah, they knock. So since I put the mezuzah, I pay 10 times more than the robberies. But the fool didn't know that when the robbers take it away, you get no reward for that. It's a punishment. When you give to tzedakah, your reward is endless. You just save it to your own saving. It's an eternal saving. I will finish by telling you this story. There's an Israeli taxi driver that is a handicap. What happened? He lost 2 of his legs up to the knees. From here down, he has proteza, fake legs. half real, half plastic, whatever they make it from. And he's a taxi driver, and he gets to drive people from the airport to whatever they need. One time he get a call, said it's an American gvir, a rich guy came from America, and he ordered a cab in advance, you know, with his name. He come, they stand on the airport with a sign. So he comes, he stand with a sign, and the guy comes in, so I'm the guy. He takes him to the limo, he puts him in. They drive towards Yerushalayim. On the airport Yerushalayim, 20 minutes, half an hour. As they're going up the hill, the guy said, do you mind if I smoke my cigar? He said, no, actually I also want to light a cigarette. No problem. So he lights his cigar, he smokes his cigar, sits in the back. Then when the driver, this Israeli driver, was about to light his cigarette, right away he took his lighter and he went like this to the front to light his cigarette for him, this rich guy. And he looked at his hand and he saw he has a number from the Holocaust, 5 or 6 digits. It's his serial number in Auschwitz. So he looked at the number, his eyes almost came out. This is an Israeli guy that was born in Israel. Right away he made a U-turn in the highway over there, if you know where I'm talking about. No, I don't think there is a U-turn. Right away he made a U-turn to the other side of the road. He began to drive like crazy towards the north. Completely the opposite side of Jerusalem. He goes towards the north of Israel. The American guy started to think maybe he's kidnapping me or something. He said, well, where are you going? He said, I can't tell you until we get there. Don't ask me. Don't worry. He drives, almost 2 hours. He finally gets to the north. He comes to a moshav. He gets quickly into the moshav. Don't move from the car. I'm going to get somebody. I want you to meet somebody. What's the story? Listen good. You never heard such a thing. When this driver was a young man, in his, you know, beginning of his 20s, he was working in a factory that make apple juice. In Israel, in a moshav, they make apple juice. They have a huge machine, and all the apples fall in, they peel the apples, they get rid of those things, and then they crush them, and all the juice comes out. So it's like a shredding. You know, they shred the apples in the beginning, when all falls in, their trucks throw all the apples in. It's a whole process. One time, few apples stuck, when they're supposed to cover it, there's a lid. They don't let the lid close down, because few apples went there to the, you know, where they're supposed to close it. So he climbed on a tank, and with his legs, he's trying to make the apples fall in, that they can close the cover. Somehow, it was wet a little bit. He slides in as the machine is working. So the machine is full of apples, slowly, it grinds the apples, and he's on top of the apples, he's trying to climb, but it's very smooth. Cannot come out, he begins to scream, but the noise of the machines is very loud, nobody hears. He scream. Nobody answers. Slowly, you see, there's maybe 3 or 4 inches of apples left. That's it, another 10 seconds, he begins to grind his legs. Nobody heard him. And he started to grind his legs all the way to the knee almost. I don't have to tell you what a tragedy. Just when he thought, that's it, I'm dead, he saw a hand, somebody saw it. But by the time this old man ran, he pressed the switch, he turned the machine off, and he pulled him out. He gave him his hand, he pulled him out of there, poor guy's all bleeding. Right away, they tie his knees that he won't lose more blood. Took him to the and saved his life. But when he gave him his hand, he saw that it's a Holocaust survivor. It's an old man from the Moshav that never said a word, was always depressed. One time, he asked him, after he saved him, they took him, he asked him, I see that you were a Holocaust survivor. Tell me a little bit about what happened to you there. He said, it was me and my brother left. They killed all my family. Me and my brother were left. And we were standing in line. They took my brother. I was supposed to go right in after him. They took him, and then they told me, no, you don't go. They turned all of us back, and they took us to a different place. And from that moment on, I never saw my brother. So probably they killed my brother, and I left alone in my world. That's why I'm quiet. You know, I'm depressed for my life. So obviously, this is the hand that saved his life. He cannot forget the number on his hand. can never forget that, you know, in such a situation, he looked at this number, this number is always in his head. So now he runs inside, he sees him. Zelmale, Zelmale, come, come, quick. It's an old man. Come, come, don't ask questions. He takes him out. Come, come. He gets the guy, the rich guy from the cab. Come out. Take up your sleeve. He puts their hand, almost the same number. One number different. His brother. He was the next one online. So he had one, the same. When they make them the numbers, it was families. So each family has a close serial number. 6,521, 6,522. That's how it was. And then that's how they met each other. In reality, everything you do for others, in the end, you really do for yourself. But not always you see it. You don't benefit from that, your children benefit from that. Your grandchildren benefit. For sure it comes back to you. That's why the Torah is so much praising chesed, 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 so much. To do for others. Why? You're a fool? What do you mean to do for others? Let me take care of myself. No, no, no. You do for others, you show that you have emunah in me. You have faith in me. Thanks to that, I will reward you. Let's do now, Bezrat Hashem, a little bit the tikkun. Maybe before we start, I just will explain to you what we're going to read. One little part which is important. The Rambam. The Rambam speaks in Elchot Deot Perek Hei. It's in page 208 in this book, for those who understand Hebrew. The Rambam says like this, wise people, now remember, the Rambam lived almost 900 years ago. And the Rambam speaks about a person who comes to get married and build himself a home. And it says like this, a person has to learn some kind of a profession, that he should have a job. He goes, he makes some efforts, he, you know, one guy is a diamond dealer, one guy sells gold, one guy is a real estate, whatever. Then he marries a woman. Right, he has parnasa, he married a woman, he built himself a home. And then right after he built himself a home, he has to do Chanukat HaBayit. As the Torah says, Mi ha'ish asher bana bayit chadash velo chanacho. Who is the person who built a home and still didn't get to do Chanukat HaBayit? Somebody like this, dismissed from going to the army. You don't take him to the war until he makes Chanukat HaBayit, he moves in, he puts mezuzot, over there, then after that he goes to the army. But if he build a house and he didn't do Chanukat HaBayit, the job is not finished. This is a pasuk in the Torah. We see from here how important it is Chanukat HaBayit. And Rambam said like this, some people, we call them the fools, even though today it's not so true anymore, because the world is completely different than what it used to be. They first get married, they don't have anything, and then they begin to worry, what are we going to do? He has a wife, sometimes a baby, and he doesn't know what to do, where to go, what to do. This is it. So the Gemara says like this. You have to build yourself a place. You plant a vineyard, which is a source of parnasa. And you have to do it in the right way, that you have blessing in everything you do. Then, a person has to know that if he has money, not to invest all his money in one thing. He has to put a third of his money in real estate, a third of his money he puts for emergency, and a third of his money for business, buy and sell. But not everything in real estate, not everything in diamonds, not everything in investments. Because you know, one little problem and you're left with nothing. The Torah says, if a person promises something, handshake with someone, he must keep his word. It's like swearing. You shake hands with someone, the diamond dealers, the Haredim, they shake hands, they say mazal u'bracha, millions of dollars, no contracts, no papers. He gives them 100 diamonds, mazal u'bracha, $4 million. When? 30 days from now, handshake, finished. Why? They know it's shvua from the Torah. It's more important than going to the secular court. If you believe in Hashem, you know that you don't play tricks here. And we finish with this. A person should always know, always let people run after him. You don't be the ones who run after them. Don't ever insult people. You be the one who get insulted. Better for you than you insult a person. And then if you behave like this, you're down to earth, you're humbled, you trust God to take revenge against those who deserve it and to reward those who deserve it. I'm not God. Whatever he wants to do, it's his point. Didn't the Hashem say, Avdi ata Israel, you are my servant Israel, asher becha et pa'ar. My glory comes from people like you. And this is just a part of what we're going to read. Let's get to the table if we